cotton plant grows to a height of 3 to 4 feet. The seed is planted usually in April. A long, warm season free from frost is very essential for its delicate growth. It requires about 35 days for the seed to develop. Towards the end of May, a small flower may be seen, but it is not until the middle of June that the first beautiful flowers appear. On the first day, the petals are creamy white, turning to a deep cream, then yellowish, and finally pink. On the second day, the blossoms turn red, and on the third day, the petals wither and fall to the ground, leaving to view a bole. Which develops until it bursts open. This bole contains 4 to 5 sections, each composed of cotton fibers, which are attached at one end to the seed, to the extent that each seed is entirely covered. Cotton picking starts in midsummer and continues into January. Most of the work is done by Negro men and women who sing, laugh, and joke as they work together. An expert picker can pick about 150 pounds a day. About 2/3 of picked cotton by weight is seed. The pickers have their bags weighed and assemble the cotton to be loaded into wagons. As soon as a wagon load of 1,500 or 1,600 pounds is picked, it is big gin. Here you see the cotton being sucked up through a pipe from the wagon into a hopper in the gin house. The cotton runs over a series of many circular saws separated by iron bars. The rapidly revolving saws pull the cotton from the seeds, while the seeds, leaves, and other impurities are held back. This shows how the gin has broken up the matted fibers. The gin cotton drops into a press box, free from seeds and other foreign matter, and is lightly pressed into a gin bale. The bale is then compressed under pressure of 2,000 pounds to the square inch into a bale which weighs about 500 pounds. The cotton is now ready for shipment to the cotton mill to be manufactured into cloth. At the cotton mill, all bales are weighed and samples drawn from each. These samples and bales are tagged so that if upon examination any is found to be not equal to specification, the tag indicates which bale to reject. The classer carefully inspects by pulling enough cotton between his thumbs and forefingers to determine its grade and quality. There are 9. Only mature cotton of long fiber can be used to produce a lasting quality fabric such as fruit of the loom. The cotton, having passed examination, is sent to the opening room. Here, 8 to 20 odd bales are laid about a traveling lattice, which leads into a bale breaker. A small portion of each bale in rotation is laid upon the lattice, the purpose being to accomplish a thorough mix. This machine removes most remaining dust, sand, plant fragments, or seed, and renders the cotton open and fluffy. The cotton then is automatically fed through the pickers and reappears as long rolls of batting called laps. 4 of these laps are drawn into one to ensure further evenness. This machine gauges the thickness of the laps so as to assure uniformity for succeeding processes. Note that a variation of only 1/2 pound is allowed in weight of each of the huge rolls. These rolls are 40 inches wide and 18 inches in diameter. The cotton now passes over thousands of fine wire needles set in fabric. The fibers are acted upon individually and made to lay parallel with each other. The lap is changed in form to a small light formation, like a filmy web known as a sliver. The extreme fineness of this web shows to what degree the cotton has been processed. The fibers are now beginning to run parallel. 6 of these slivers are run through 4 sets of rollers, which revolve at different speeds. These rollers stretch and combine the 6 slivers into one. Short fibers, which would weaken the final thread, are removed by the rollers and caught by cloth pads. This operation is repeated with two slivers merging into one. The next process is a slight twisting which strengthens the interlocked fibers. The yarn is wound on bobbins a foot long. This operation is again repeated and two strands of roving merge as one. This doubling reduces the size of the strand and increases its strength. You see the bobbins of several stages of roving which show the reduction in size of the strand. Two different yarns are required to weave a sheet. The cotton is now being spun into fine yarn. It is not practical to spin enough warp yarn onto a bobbin to carry on the process of weaving. Therefore, the lengths of several bobbins are wound on a spool capable of holding a large quantity. At 1,650 feet per minute, the yarn is unwound and laid side by side upon a huge spool called a section beam. To protect the yarn from being chafed or broken during the weaving process, the beams are given a coating of adhesive substance to add strength. The beams are dried on steam-heated drums. The threads from 12 section beams are now wound onto one spool called a loom beam. From this, each thread is drawn through a flat piece of copper called a drop wire, then passed through an eye in the harness and through a dent in the reed. This enables the individual threads to be manipulated as required to form the weave. The filling threads are supplied to a magazine holding 28 bobbins. As the filling bobbin in the shuttle becomes empty, it is automatically thrown out and a full bobbin inserted without interrupting the weaving process. The drop wire falls out of place if one of the threads should break. You can see the effect of a broken thread. In slow motion is shown the movement of the shuttle. As alternate warp ends are spread apart by the harness, this permits the shuttle to pass through the opening and lay the filling thread. The reed moves horizontally, holding the warp, and beats the filling into a wear-resisting fabric. The shuttle passes through the opening 154 times a minute in a normal operation. Here is a typical weaving room. There are 1,040 looms in this room.